let's say you have two ad sets that, like, again, you're just changing one thing, or you're doing a formal split test on Facebook. Mm-hmm. You can't trust Facebook's, you know, numbers there if you're doing it that way. You actually have to plug it into a statistical significance calculator. Mm-hmm. So let's say your CPA is $32 on one ad set and $30 on another. What is the probability that it's due to random chance? You don't know. So although you think, oh, 30 is better than 32, it might be due to random chance based on your sample size. Mm-hmm. So you actually have to plug that into a calculator to determine if it's statistically significant enough of a difference to deem that is not due to random chance.
We're back for our first live episode in person with my partner in crime, as always, Ash Mawani.
What's going on?
Dylan Ander, splittesting.com, the best CRO agency on the planet. We're going to go through a bunch of cool stuff today, creative, split testing. You have some really cool brands that you work with that we'll also talk about as well. But you're actually a bit of a dark horse on Twitter. So for people that don't know you, why don't you give us some of your background and then we'll just jump in.
Yeah, 100%. So been in econ my whole life. In college, I started a print-on-demand store for sloths. Like, the number one seller was like sloth prints on the butt. It was awesome. Geez. And it was like, I'm lazy. So we were drop shipping back in the good old Facebook and ATM days, you know, good old. But we started there. I felt rich. But the thing is, the reason why I did super well versus other people, there was a tool called splittesting.com back in the day. It was a free split testing tool. We were not the creators of it. Their domain expired and we inherited splittesting.com.
Wow.
Full disclosure, I don't want to pretend like we were those guys. But when I was in college, I was literally 17, 18 years old and split testing my headlines back in the day, because it just like made sense in my head before split testing was much of a thing. Like, Jeff Bezos had a quote, you know, he said that he attributes 90% of his success to experimentation, meaning split testing.
Sure.
Right. So if you're not split testing your store, obviously do it. It's super important. So that was our differentiator, where I would like 20% boost on a, you know, lander and boom, scale my ad spend. I'd feel like a rich college kid and it was awesome. So I carried that out and eventually, I don't know if you know Instagress, that follow unfollow software back in the day, helped work on the API there.
Oh,
and I white labeled like 50 different people for them to go sell Instagram automation services.
Wow.
So I got my sales in, I got my services in, I kind of learned the ropes there. And then I just had an agency because a friend like needed some marketing help. I was like $5,000 a month. And I was like, I don't know, 20, 21. I was like, it's a lot of money, boys. Let's do it. Yo, anyone know how to do SEO? And we just figured it out that way. I don't know if you guys have started agencies before, but when you first start, it's like, you know, you literally, I don't know, hey, someone needs Facebook ads. Oh yeah, we've got a guy, like, we'll do it, of course. And like, you start and do it and do it. And there was, so that's Next Core Media, which most people know me from.
Yeah.
And Next Core Media grew and grew. We had Geico and Planet Fitness. I was doing a massive SEO contract with Geico. I was consulting for Planet Fitness on some of their new ventures. And then eventually I kind of let all my employees go, all my clients go, because I was just so miserable. Like, dark time, agency's rough. But now, so at that point, what I did, this was about three and a half years ago, I pivoted the agency and I was like, well, like, you know, media buying is cool, like a 2-to-1, 3-to-1, 5-to-1 on your money. Where could I get people like 100x ROI? Like, literally, if I'm going to go in on the services and that CRO, which is pretty solid, because one split test can make a global increase. I mean, things like your header, your footer, your nav, like, you know, like tons of things are all on every page in the site. So a tweak in there. I just recently did a split test for a company called Corkskull. Literally 1.2 million in new revenue because we changed one word in the header. Like, it's crazy what it does. So I just wanted to create that service that like creates long-lasting wealth and huge improvements to all these
ripples.
Clients. And, you know, and as ad costs only get more and more expensive, you need to convert better to, you know, compete on those CPMs, as Ash can talk about for days.
I love that. And Tom is going to kill me because I always say I love that. First off, though, I do want to give a shout out to you for scraping yourself together to come to this. You were just recently at probably one of the best festivals worldwide.
Bonnaroo, right? Baby.
Yeah, so definitely. I appreciate it. What was the best act?
Do you know churches?
Yes.
Dude.
With a V, right?
Yeah, with a V. They're amazing. A metal band live. Like, they literally, like, it's crazy.
Really?
And fun fact, too, I've actually written 3 Billboard Hot 100 songs. I used to be a full-time songwriter in Nashville while I was running my e-com brand.
Who is this guy?
What are we doing with that?
Who is this guy?
I ran D1 college, boys. That's about all the fame I have. But yeah, bringing it back to the metal, one of the interesting things, no pun intended, was we have a forecasting calculator in Triple Whale. And the thing that blows my mind is if you can just move a conversion rate by 1 or 2%, it's like the tide that lifts all boats, where it's just such an interesting, like, I mean, it's just absolutely massive impact. I mean, you guys really, you have a really actually interesting testing infrastructure. So yeah. I want you to kind of take us through that, because you kind of have this low fidelity, fast moving, and then you move it into kind of a high fidelity. Yeah. And I want you to tear it apart or tell him what he's doing well or not well.
I'm a New Yorker, baby.
Let's go. Yeah. Shout out NYC.
Absolutely. No, I mean, I've kind of told the story, you know, over and over again, but I think the biggest thing that kind of helped us get through the iOS updates was split testing a lot of things, right? We used to do a lot of big changes first and then kind of dial each winner and then split test, you know, the smaller things, right? So, you know, probably August, September-ish, you know, is when we saw that impact of the iOS updates, you know, costs were going up. We weren't testing enough creatives, and we really thought like, okay, the platform is just being the way that it is, and that's all we can do, right? We just have to wait. But you don't have to wait. You shouldn't wait, right? It's like you can go and start making 4 or 5 different landing pages and see if you can even just double your conversion rate, right? Like you, like all of, I think the last 2 years, we were using a single landing page and we made no changes whatsoever. And it got us to where we were, which was fine, but now things are harder. You have to go and literally test, I think, multiple landing pages at least quarterly, right? You know, at least have a cadence where you're setting up 4 different landing pages structurally. This way you know that like these big changes could probably move the needle way more than just split testing headlines, but that comes next, right? So what we ended up doing is like we tested 4 to 5 different styles of landing pages, found our winner. You know, there was one specific winner that just blew past everything else. And then that is where we started dialing in, right? That's when you start split testing your headlines, moving the placement of your CTA buttons. You know, do we put the buy boxes at the bottom? Do you put it at the top? Where do you put social proof? These things is where now, if you have like a baseline of like 5% conversion rate, how do you get it to 6 to 7 to 8, right? So that's like the biggest thing that we've kind of utilized and like pulled as like the main lever of these like rising ad costs to really like just convert more people.
Yeah.
Right. Cost is going to go up. Like we saw it last year. Our CPC was like on average 1.9, so $1.90. Today it's like $3.20. Right. Jeez. But we're converting double.
Yeah.
So that's how I think we've kind of like survived. But now getting past that like 20K a day in spend, we have to improve the conversion rate a little bit more. And then also balancing increasing AOV.
Right.
So that's kind of where I wanted to kind of learn from you, where like, okay, where's that balance of increasing conversion rate? Because you can do that. You could be like, hey, buy this $30 product. There's nothing else available, straight to checkout, boom, bang, like that's it. Mm-hmm. But then like your CAC is probably still $30, $40. Mm-hmm. So now how do I get that $60 AOV? How do I get that $100 AOV with maintaining conversion rate? So that's like the biggest thing I think brands should be focusing on, and wondering if you have any tips for everyone out there.
I mean, got a couple.
There you go.
Tossed it up.
So first thing that I always said, I made a tweet that not a lot of people liked about a month ago, where I said, any brand that is even remotely profitable that rebuilds their website, absolute idiots. Mm. If anyone is considering a full site redesign and a rebrand, I've literally changed a font and conversions tanked or increased. Right. So like things as little as changing like maybe your dark logo versus your light logo, like in your header, all of it matters. So would you ever run ads without attribution? Hell no.
Right.
So would you ever change a whole page on your site, changing like 20 or 30 things and not knowing which made the change? Yeah. So the thing about landers, which I'll get into in a second, is like if you're testing different landers, you have a baseline. It's almost like putting a Band-Aid though, if I'm being honest, where let's say you test one new lander in like a new structure. I don't want to say advertorial. Let's say it's a, you know, tit for tat. You want to move the buy box. You're doing a URL redirect test, that type of stuff. The incremental improvement, you need to understand each level that's changing. So if you change like 7 or 8 things in the landers, you're not going to know which of those 7 or 8 things happened. So let's say you get a net 15% increase. There might be an element that has a net like minus 4% increase.
Right.
But so it could have been a 19% if you incrementally did each of them versus, you know, like having no attribution of which change actually made the change. So that's the one gripe with testing new landers. So first off, never rebuild your whole website. That's just doesn't work.
Yeah.
So for different landers, the thing I'll say about focusing on landers is where a lot of people overlook CRO is the offer, right? So one thing that you guys do a great job, I always preach like the power of free, mm-hmm. which is what can you give away for free? You can give away info products, you can give away content, you can give access, early access, you know, app access. Like there's so many things you can give away. Like you guys give away, I think the free scooper.
Shaker cup, scooper,
all of those.
Yeah.
All the merch. So I made a thread like, I don't know, also like a month ago and shouted you guys out because you did a good job. So yeah, it's in the offer itself. So the way that we start every campaign for true CRO is go and ask your customers what they want. Because mm-hmm. you guys, like for Triple L, for Avi, like you guys may think you know what your customers want,
right?
But only they know.
Sure.
And like if anyone says, click this or I would do that, immediately fire that team member, get rid of them or slap yourself in the face. Because you as one person, you're not necessarily the demographic of 100%. User, right? Yeah. I don't know if you own an e-com store, yeah. that you're not the demographic of user. So you go and ask your customers, customer feedback survey. Why do you buy from us? You know, what makes is different. What's the best part of the experience? Get a little bit of the emotional side, like for e-com brands, like, you know, like what are you looking for when looking for collagen or supplements, right? Like what do you hate about supplements? You know, all that type of stuff. And you get it and you shape your offer.
Mm-hmm.
And with the landers, making sure that your offer is well shaped, like that's so overlooked that I would rather you take four identical landers and just kind of change up the actual offer itself.
Yeah.
And then from there, start testing the rest of those landers. Right. So it's like get the meat and potatoes, which you can double your conversion rate by figuring it out. So mm-hmm. I also own a couple of supplement brands. So on one of them, we added plus like, you know, get a free ebook.
Right.
And it smashed conversion rate. It was awesome. So huge increase, like where you offer that little like free, the little free product, try like plus a free, you know, one of the things for like hair loss is probably one of your biggest pain points for
yep.
collagen.
Yep.
So how to maintain 10, you know, an ebook of 10 ways to maintain positive yep. hair, right? That's like smart. That's the kind of thing that you can add as an offer to increase conversion rate fundamentally. Forget the tweaks, forget anything. Like you have yep. to obviously have to A/B test this and, you know, make sure that one offer is converting better than others. But that's really the meat and potatoes of it. So it's like ask your customers and formulate an offer. So it's like before you touch your lander, before you touch anything, just go on a walk, like deep breath, put yourself one thing. Shout out Nick Harris. He's our new chief strategy Love officer me. At splittesting.com. Nick, it's at Nick D to C with a two, D2C. Shout out, Nick. We love you.
Just recently on Mentor Pass as well. Shout out, Kenny.
Shout out, Kenny. I just joined, actually, I think, like yesterday.
Amazing. Nice.
So, killing it. If you guys need some support and help, I'm here to help. So, Nick, he actually taught me about, like, you know, he worked at a lot of nine-figure brands before, empathy mapping, which is every step of you have an issue with hair loss.
Mm.
You, therefore, go to Google and start Googling what is your experience and emotions you have at that point. When you go to the next stage and you're doing your research, how do you feel? What emotions are going on there? And literally mapping the empathy of the customer all the way through. And this also goes to retention, email marketing, text messaging, like literally empathy mapping the entire process of like from before they find you to when they're becoming a raving fan.
Right.
When is weakest? You know, it's kind of like also a self-analysis of, cool, they take it 20 days in, they don't, you know, or like, for example, like, on supplements, like with my brands, 3 days in, hey, my joints still hurt. This thing doesn't work. And I'm like, hey, you need to give it like 2 weeks to yeah. really work, especially collagen
yeah.
as well.
Yeah.
So now start on the empathy mapping, right? Where right after the post-purchase emails, like 2 or 3 days in, like, hey, I know you're waiting. Think long-term, 2 to 4 weeks, right? So you're able to map every single stage
right.
And getting that empathy mapping all along. So Nick turned us on to empathy mapping, which absolutely changed the game for acquisition, because by looking at how they're going to feel over here, you can market it other than just saying like, hey, let's solve the problem. No. Like, let's actually like, the problem and like solution is really well defined, and like there's a pathway, and it makes it so much easier to tell the story,
yep.
make good ads, good creatives that teach it, you know, that they can really harp on. Like maybe like for collagen, like hair loss, there's like four situations. I don't know, like you have a receding hairline, it's thinning like, yeah, you know, there's a exactly. couple different angles yeah. that yep. you have to go and test those subtopics. And how yep. do you do it?
Yep.
Customer feedback survey.
Yep.
Ta-da. So it's like just literally map the USPs. That's it. Yeah.
That's literally what we do.
Yeah.
The empathy map is really interesting because I enjoy something called jobs to be done. And there's something similar where there's two ways that you can kind of identify the job to be done. One, you basically have this essentially like buyer journey, but it's a little more nuanced than that, or the forces. They're it's same but different. And the forces are interesting because you don't only get a purchase when you have these pushing and pulling forces essentially, and you only get the purchase or the behavior change when you get, they call it a tip in there. So it's really similar in terms of that empathy mapping. I really like that. So we're not talking over people's heads. Can you explain explain to a five-year-old kind of what A/B testing is, so people that aren't kind of hip to it and kind of know what we're talking about, give them a little foundational knowledge there.
Yeah, exactly. So I'm going to kind of take it through the lens of how I do the CRO campaign, which is CRO is just conversion rate optimization. If you get 100 people to your website, how many people purchase?
Okay,
that is known as your conversion rate, which, you know, most people know what the conversion rate is. It's just the art of increasing your conversion rate is what CRO has become. It's more of an umbrella term where boosting your average order value, like, you know, it's really just revenue per user. So if someone clicks on your website, how much is that worth for you? So he said it costs about $3.20. If you're making $4.20, like 420 Blaze, then like, you know, you're then you're making, you know, you're definitely making profit there. Yeah. So understanding the revenue per user or conversion rate, they're a little bit, you know,
same,
makes sense, different. Right? Same, right. But different. So, you know, you go to your customer feedback survey, then you go to heat mapping, which is, you know, seeing how people interact with your website. Yeah. There's, you know, we use Hotjar at our agency. Strong, so we use all the click maps, scroll maps, see how people interact with the website. So that's another thing that we do of like qualitative data that we put in, because people are clicking on a photo that doesn't go anywhere. There's clearly a problem with how it's like presented, you know,
right.
If people like, if there's like a nav bar that has like six things across and people don't click on two of them, remove them. It's probably going to help your conversion rate.
Yeah,
so
right.
There's things like that that will help. And then ultimately, after we get to that, we do this massive audit. So we become like professionals in your brands of whatever brand we're working on. And then it turns into split testing.
Got it.
So split testing is, or another known as A/B testing.
Right.
A/B testing, like I like using split testing because you can have many variants, right?
Yeah.
So it's not just an A and a B. It could be A, B, C, D, E, F, G.
Yeah.
And then there's a whole bunch of multivariate tests where you're changing A and B and then C and D and they go against each other.
Yeah.
So, but the whole point, long story short, is that you're testing different things on your website. Button color is the most simple to someone who's just starting an e-commerce, which is you have a green button. If we get 100 people to the green button or 1,000 people for the green button and 1,000 people for a red button, we can see how much revenue comes in for the green button and the red button.
Yeah.
And that's just the most simple example of, cool, if the red button has more revenue per user, like revenue per click, then awesome. I'm probably going to go ahead with the red button and implement it on the pages that we do. So you can change literally anything. My developers have shown me that there's nothing that can't be split tested on a website, and it's been awesome. So does that kind of scratch that itch?
That's incredibly helpful. The other question I had, so there's, everybody throws around a term, statistical significance. So I have a question about that. And then the other question too that I had is, you were talking about earlier, I think the fancy term is controls. If you have too many changes to the page, you don't have a really good controlled experiment because you don't know, like to your point, one change might have been a plus 20% push, but then you also had this other change that was a minus 5, and so another change that was a minus 2, then another change that was like a minus 3, and so net you're seeing a plus 10 increase. But if you'd only done that plus 20 thing and you would have done it in a more controlled manner, if you will, where you're only testing one or two variables at a time, you get a lot more insight from the experiment. So I guess first question, can you explain kind of statistical significance? What are you looking for there? Is it like an impression rate? Is it something, or impression threshold or traffic or what have you? And then also, do you think it's good ever to test a lot of variables, or should you always be doing like one or two kind of max?
Totally. So statistical significance, I'm just going to go stat sig. That's what we call it. So if something is stat sig or not, every single piece of marketing, whether it's email marketing, Facebook ads, like the best media buyers sit there, plug it into a calculator to see if something's stat sig.
Right.
So what statistical significance actually means is the percentage that a change is due to random chance, right? Because if I flip a coin, which is, you know, 50-50 on heads and tails, if I flip it 1,000 times in a row, it can land on heads 1,000 times in a row.
Right.
So it's the, you know, the random chance that like your version is. So the, you know, you can never have 100% statistical significance because that means something is fact, but it could be 99.999999.
Sure,
so, you know, in science, like, and like medical studies, there's like, you know, a version of someone without the medicine and someone with the medicine.
Sure.
In the medical communities, if you have like a 99.1, that's considered like dangerous to put in mankind.
Yeah.
With us, we can go as low as an 85-90% confidence interval. Right. So for whatever you're doing, it you need two things, right? So like 1,000 people visited here and 28 purchased, 1,000 people here and, you know, 40 purchased, right? You just plug that into a statistical significance calculator to not make it fancy. So let's say, you know, a big gripe I have on media buyers is, let's say you have two ad sets that, like, again, you're just changing one thing, or you're doing a formal split test on Facebook. Mm-hmm. You can't trust Facebook's, you know, numbers there if you're doing it that way. You actually have to plug it into a statistical significance calculator. Mm-hmm. So let's say your CPA is $32 on one ad set and 30 on another. What is the probability that it's due to random chance? You don't know. So although you think, oh, 30 is better than 32, it might be due to random chance based on your sample size. Mm-hmm. So you actually have to plug that into a calculator to determine if it's statistically significant enough of a difference to deem that is not due to random chance. Because 30 versus 32, fundamentally, if you assume that it's always going to be 30, you don't know for sure as a predictor of the future, but you'll know if something's statistically significant between two different ones. So
love that stat sig.
So stat fancy. Sig, baby.
I'm hip to it, baby. Yeah. How
damn, you looking stat sig today?
Stat sig, amazing.
Well, what is that? What does that number look like for you guys when you're running your test? Right? Mm-hmm. Is there a minimum like sessions per experiment that you guys are looking for to get to that? You mm-hmm. know, stat sig.
So. It's a hot take because there's a lot of opinions on this.
Yeah.
Because if you're a small store, like for example, I come to you and there's a test and I say, hey, Ash, there's an 84% chance, right? Like based on the statistical significance, mm-hmm. 84% chance that this change that we have here will make you an additional $40,000 per month. There's still a chance that it could be negative, right? Like, you mm-hmm. know, there's 16% mm-hmm. that I gave. So like there's a 16% chance that this is completely random,
right?
And there's an 84% chance that it's going to be a $40,000 increase. Would you like me to implement that on your site? Yes or no?
Yeah, you'd take that bet.
Right. Yeah. Most people would take that bet. So it's like that type of thing where a lot of people say 95% or nothing, right? Like
right.
when you learn in high school, it's like yeah. a p-value. So if
right.
you
right.
subtract the statistical significance, p-value is 0.05, so 95% statistically significant. So for us, if it's below 85, we kind of say to the entrepreneur like that we're working with, hey, like this is kind of your decision. Here's the facts. Here's exactly mm. what it is. It's below our desired threshold.
Right.
But the way that we implement it is if we see all signs, right? So let's say your conversion rate increased because you have a KPI, like key performance indicator of what you're trying to increase. Some yeah. split tests were trying to increase average order value.
Yeah.
Some were trying to increase conversion rate. Some were trying to increase add to cart rate and don't care about the purchases. Sure. There's so many different like test types that you can you run.
Sign right. up, what have you.
Yeah, exactly.
Terminating event can be whatever you want type of thing.
Just like ads, you yeah. know, like yeah. deeper in the funnel 100%. Is typically better. So, yeah, I mean, the minimum is really like what we evaluate. So if you go in Google Optimize, which it's free, guys, I recommend you use Google Optimize. The drag and drop feature isn't always the best. You kind of need to know how to code, if I'm being yeah, honest.
Like, I've broken multiple sites, honestly.
Yeah, so we use Google Optimize, but no joke, if we're swapping a photo, my dev, like one of my lead devs who's really good, can take 2 hours to make that test because what about all the different sizes of screens? It's got to look perfect everywhere.
Yeah, right.
So a lot of people just swap in a photo, hope, you know, from Shopify
work, right?
And they think it's going to work and it tanks. It's like, well, this objectively is way better. It's like, yeah, because it's not dynamic. There's different
yeah.
mobile types. There's like, there's a lot to go on there. So
right.
it takes a bunch. And then last part of that is there's also secondary metrics.
Mm-hmm.
So let's say our main KPI is like purchases, right? So we were, sorry, conversion rate. We care more about lowering our CAC than actual like ROAS, right?
Mm-hmm.
So like there's a difference between the two.
Right.
You just want the lowest cost per new customer. So like net CPA.
Of course.
If you're working on that front end conversion rate, take a look at your add to carts. Every time you get an add to cart with your abandoned email sequence and assuming you have a text message sequence, you get a value per add to cart.
Right.
So if that has gone up, but your conversion rate stayed the same,
true.
Maybe that's good to implement. Yeah. Let's say your average order value has gone up, but your conversion rate's the same.
It's great.
Might want to implement it. So there's secondary metrics. And let's say you're focusing on SEO and things like that. Dwell time, time on site, number of pages you visited, all inside of Google Optimize. It links in like directly to Google Analytics. So there's not a single stat that you can't see. Well, I mean, maybe like per channel, Google Analytics gets a little wonky. That's the only thing I don't trust Google Analytics for. But otherwise, if it's hard-coded and set up properly, that's where it is. So people saying there's a number of like sessions I need and stat sig and all of that where 85 is my general rule. If like, yeah, it's like, you know, gun to my head, I would say if it's below 85, it's kind of not the best, but it's really advanced where you look at all the secondary metrics. If everything looks positive, but your first needle mover didn't happen.
Yeah.
You may still want to actually implement it. So it's case by case, but anyone feel free to DM me with a Google Analytics or Google Optimized screenshot and I'll tell you what to do. Yeah.
No, hot takes. Like, okay. So, for example, right? Say, let's take the red button, blue button, right? Are you looking at, if for example, you have 100 visitors and obviously blue is in the lead, right? Let's just say, is that enough for you to decide or pull the plug on that? Or like, I feel like you need a certain, at least for us when we're doing it, we're doing at least 5,000 sessions per variant, just so that we know that, okay, there's no chance, there's no randomness at all.
Yeah.
So like, is there a set number that you guys go with, or is it more so like, I guess it's kind of maybe up to the owner as well. Like they want to cut it at some point, you know?
Exactly. So if you ask the data purists, right, like statisticians, not marketers, like they would say we would need 1,000 conversions for sure.
1,000 conversions.
Conversions.
Got it.
Right? So purchases.
Right.
So that's not how we go at our firm, right? Because not every brand's, and I mean, we've got plenty of 8-9-figure brands that, you know, we've got a couple thousand per variant, you know, even if it's multivariant, like of like, you know, 7 or 8 versions.
Right.
That's where it starts. Transparently, we used to work, you know, when we started out, we worked with smaller brands. We were a smaller agency. And we had a minimum of 1,000 sessions that we would need per variant. And we would never call a test. I don't care if it has to run forever.
Right.
I don't care if it has to run for 3 months. Can't have less than 1,000 sessions. Because if you think about it, if you flip a coin 1,000 times, do you trust where it's going to land?
Yeah. Mm-hmm.
I kind of do. I think it's going to be close to 50-50. So 1,000 is kind of, if you just think about it, I mean, it's completely arbitrary.
Right.
But 1,000 per variant is my bare minimum.
Fair.
We never, even still today, no matter what it is, cannot do 1,000 per variant. So if you have a 5-way test, you need 1,000 in each one. But also, I'm not condoning once you're at 1,000, leave it. The more you can afford to run, that's the whole point.
Right.
That's how I feel, where ultimately, one, I think it is a function of the business size, because not only do you not have the data, but you don't have the time. Like, you can't wait for, like, you need to, like, and so if you can at least derive directionality from it and saying, like, hey, you know, like, if you're a small business, like, it matters, where, like, if you're a small business and you move your conversion rate up, like, 1 or 2%, it's not really that big of a deal. But when you're an 8-9-figure brand, like, a 1%, 1-point bump on your conversion rate is, like, almost business changing. So I think there's a certain aspect of understanding the context of the actual impact of the changes, where it's just, like, 100 sessions probably isn't enough, but maybe 500 is. And, like, you can, for me, it's almost like the sniff test of, like, if you showed this to 500 people, what do you think? Okay, cool. Right. Are you fine to go ahead with that? Okay, let's go. Because, like, to your point, Dylan, like, 1,000 conversions might be a 3-month, a quarter period for some brands, where it's just like, you know, so you have to get into that. That's incredible. Question, how does Google optimize, or how do all these people do the holdouts? Is it cookies, or like, how do they bifurcate kind of the audiences that are going to see these different things? Because ideally, you don't want people polluting each, like, if you're in cohort A or cohort B or cohort C, you don't want any kind of cross-pollination, correct?
Exactly. So Google Optimize, it's set and forget in that regard. So if you land on a session ID, even if you come back, right? So let's say I visit a product page, green button instead of like a red button. If I come back to that same page like a day later, if the test is still running, I will see that green button again. Okay. So it's kind of like a not, like, you kind of don't have to think about it if you're using, you know, any like the paid ones that are really expensive, like VWO, AB Tasty, Optimizely, they're all the same, but so is Google Optimize.
Got it.
If they visit once, there's a session ID, and if they come back, you don't have to worry about it. They're still going to see the same one.
Got it.
But then if you cut the test and you're at something new, and you know, you're back to your code base. Yeah, exactly.
Amazing. Yeah. Awesome. What's the craziest test you've seen? Like, in terms of performance, where you're, because we were talking a little bit offline about, like, you're changing like X, Y, or Z, and you're like, oh my gosh, we made $1 bazillion for our brand. Like, what are some crazy kind of, weird tests that you have seen before where you're like, oh, that's weird, or that's interesting kind of stuff?
Yeah. So one of my senior CROs at splittesting.com, one big thing that I always say is above the fold on mobile, get your damn add to cart button above the fold on your fucking mobile device.
Yeah.
So one thing about it is when you go into Google Analytics, go to device, and I believe it's screen type, right, or there's a secondary filter for screen type. You can take an average of the screen resolution of the mobile phones that visit your website. So when you make mockups, you should use that default, right, because there's people who have smaller phones or much larger phones. So optimize for the ones that your customers are. So that's a really good deep tip that most people don't know. But again, go to that average and make sure that average at all costs, that add to cart button, is above the fold on mobile. So one time, one of my senior CROs was like, well, Dylan, like, there's the quantity selector. Do you want me to remove it? And I was like, fuck it. Yeah. Why not?
Yeah.
AOV. And they're like, well, the AOV is going to get hurt a lot, right? Because like, you know, cool, you give them the option. Yeah. We looked at the heat map and two people out of 20,000 visitors clicked on the quantity selector.
That's amazing.
And then I was like, wait, hold on. And then I went to three other clients, I don't know, 10 in 10,000, like literally point something percent of customers are using that quantity selector. So hot take, quantity selectors suck. You know, you need to make your buy box actually be the ones that work. So we removed quantity selector. And now what we started doing is we put the quantity selector last, and then there's a variant of just completely removing it. 9 times out of 10, which is probably stat sig.
There you go.
Yeah. So okay, we actually have a killer database of over 1,500 split tests we ran. So like internally, we kind of get to see what's working and not, which is the benefit. So yeah, we get that add to cart button above the fold no matter what. So even if there's quantities – or not quantity selectors, but like for example, like there's variants. So whether they're colors for fashion or they're flavors for supplements, we take that add to cart button and we've been adding it above that.
But I remember you said that.
So we literally added above there. So it's like, wait, so you're saying the add to cart button goes above like my t-shirt size? And I'm saying, yeah. So first off, do not go at anyone at home. Don't go and do this. Don't just go, you have to test it.
Like, A/B test
like
I say, that.
Like that's the whole point. Like,
this is not financial advice.
This is not financial advice. Yeah. So on this unqualified opinion and not financial advice. Yeah. Like we found that to be like a hot take test that like get it above the fold. So that buy button in like you need high contrast, right? Green is something you usually test. It's known to be one of the most inviting colors. That like obviously green button gang. I kind of want to make a hashtag on Twitter, like green button gang.
Green button.
I've tossed it a couple times.
Yeah. Merch.
Shit.
Put that on a shirt.
Damn.
Great merch. Yeah.
So yeah, getting it above the fold is just like crucial. So, you know, forget the quantities and all that. But the only thing with that is none can be pre-selected. Because what will happen, we found out on customer service, is if that add to cart button is above the fold, right? And they like it and they just click on it. Let's say there's strawberry, banana, and chocolate. The default will be the strawberry. So, but that add to cart button, they just like click it and go and buy. They may have wanted the banana or the chocolate. So you need to make sure that like when you click the add to cart button, the little error message says you need to pick a selection. So make sure there's no pre-selected ones on there. As long as there's no pre-selected, put that add to cart button, like literally almost like, so like, you know, product it, like product photo, title, the reviews, price, button. Like literally nothing before any content, before anything. And it also helps price anger. So price angering is another thing that's huge. So a lot of people say the larger the AOV, the smaller the text should be. The, you know, smaller the AOV, the larger the text should be, like the size of the actual price. We found that to be like not necessarily the most true. I'd give it like a 70-30 that like that's wrong based on our like database of tests. We find almost always getting that price larger makes a huge difference. So the three things that you want them to notice right away, well, four things really, which is the product, what it looks like, the name of it, the price of it, and where they can buy it, which is the add to cart button. So those are the four things. So it's called price anchoring, where if you're buying sneakers, which I know you hate, if you're looking at like $750 sneakers versus $75 sneakers, you shop differently.
Yes.
So you as the e-com owner, it is your job to make sure they know how to scan the website, which is price anchoring. So just running a test where you have this big, fat, bold price, even if it's an ugly $5,000 price tag, which is a lot of money for most consumers, still want it nice and big because it's your responsibility to make sure. So those are two hot takes. I've definitely got some others. One that we've been doing recently as well, which is hard to test and optimize if you don't have sick developers. Shout out, Keith. We love you. The second photo being UGC in your carousel.
You guys do that really well, don't you?
It was one of my CRO hacks. I don't know if Ash has been scooping off me on Twitter.
Amazing.
A little bit.
He's on it. Watch him. Watch him. I'm giving too much. Damn, I'm getting out of a gig.
Well, one thing that you... So just from listening to you now, right? There's so many things I want to go back and test, right? So now for people who are like watching and like writing down these notes, like, hey, I gotta change the font size of price. I gotta move the add to cart button. I gotta do this. I gotta do that. What's the best way to structure all these tests and kind of carry it out efficiently for people, you know, with, let's say like you have, I don't know, maybe give the structure for, you know, small to mid-sized businesses so that they can kind of carry out these tests.
So it's the same for everyone.
Yeah.
Top, down. That is it. So if you go on Hotjar, which you can download for free, so no matter what size business you are, go and download Hotjar for free. It'll take a while for sessions to collect, but there's click maps, which is where you see what people are clicking on, and scroll maps. So one of the hidden tricks is looking at the scroll map because it obviously goes down, you know, less and less, right? So if you think about it, if 100% of people are looking at everything above the fold and only 12% are looking at the footer, above the fold will have almost 10 times the impact of what's in the footer.
Right.
So it doesn't mean things on the bottom aren't good, right? Because sometimes like you want a long form page and just the buy box at the bottom, but we always start top down because above the fold is what has most of the like massive improvements because the most people see it. Right. So if you're testing something that's two or three, like we call them buckets down the page, if you're testing the third bucket on your page, you may only get 40% of people seeing that.
Right.
So you definitely want things that 100% of people see.
Right. Okay. And then so, for example, within these buckets, right, say you want to do like, let's just talk about the product page, right? The buy box section, right? There's like about three or four things that you can test there, right?
Yeah.
Mm-hmm. Are you doing one test at a time? Are you doing like a multivariate test? Is that, if you're doing a test at a time, is that over like 4 weeks? Did you do it in a week? Like, what does that structure look like? Yeah.
So the same way that we had a minimum of that 1,000 per variant, 2 weeks is the minimum for how long a test has to run.
Right.
Never run
traffic a test. Traffic agnostic.
Interesting. Even if you get to a certain level. And the reason is weekday traffic reacts differently than weekend traffic.
Makes sense.
So if you do it for 1 week, you may have a really impressive weekend or a sale or something like that. So if you have two of them, exactly, it normalizes 2 weeks, gives you enough that like it is. So for our agency, you know, we've biweekly calls and, you know, biweekly tests. That's the whole point. So it's like you need to let it run for 2 weeks. Minimum. So I don't care if it's, and the other thing too is if you're like a really nine figure brand, you can just select and Google optimize like 20% of your traffic for testing. So think about it in terms of ads, like what percent of your ad spend is testing?
10%. Yeah.
So cool. So if you want to be really conservative, use 10% of your traffic for testing.
Yeah.
If you're a smaller brand, you'll have to use 100, but that's a little more risky,
right?
So it's kind of risk reward based on your side. The larger you are, the more flexibility you have, which, you know. That answers.
When I was at my old agency and we would do like the brand lift tests and stuff like that, that was always a challenge because you can only do it with this audience and then you have this holdout and it would be like, usually you want to test against like your best audience and there was this kind of, again, to your point, like this risk reward of like, we're going to get learnings, but at the same time, like by definition, the goal isn't performance, it's the learnings. And so you would have to kind of weigh the risk and reward, like you said there. Do you ever cut off a test early? Like when you see it shit the bed and you're like, oh my God, I can't like waste any more traffic?
If it's negatively statistically significant.
What is that? Whoa. No.
Hold on. So we're just like a change.
Realm now.
No, Bonnaroo is a different realm. So the same way an increase can be statistically significant, a decrease can be statistically significant. So it might be negative 95% or negative 85%. So what you can do is you can cut that test variant so more traffic goes to the rest.
Got it.
So there will be a point when it's like damn, we're like a week in. So I will test for a week. So a week is my minimum. No matter what, if you press a button, a week is the bare minimum that you can go. Right. At a week mark, then you can, because there's like, we call them shark fins, because yep. it can vary day to day, just like Google Analytics or Facebook ads if you put it on a graph. So your daily shark fins, you know, at least a week will like remove the shark fin.
Got it.
Makes sense.
That is interesting.
So you can cut after 1 week if it's really, really bad, but you can't promote a winner in a week. Must mm-hmm. be 2 weeks.
Yep. Yeah, no, that makes a ton of sense. I actually like that. Do you find reductive or additive testing is better? Like, do you think when you take away stuff is better, or do you like to add stuff?
Totally depends on the brand, and okay. we have data to back that up.
Yeah.
Fashion brands, when you look at it, like sneakers, a lot of them, like yeah. there's like your, you know, your above the fold stuff, like your add to cart button, description, warranty, shipping, and testimonials, and that's it. So something like supplements, what you put in your body is sacred. Consumables are like sacred. There's a lot of info.
Sneakers are sacred. So,
too, so yeah. well, I mean, relax, man.
easy.
easy, dude. Easy. So yeah, it really does depend on the industry. So, okay. but I mean, like as an agency, I would say a lot of the times we come in and people are like, man, we've added this thing. We've like worked harder. That's one thing that a lot of like people at home think, that like the physically larger the test on the screen, the bigger the test, right? We've changed small little things mm-hmm. that like are physically small on the screen, mm-hmm. but make a massive difference. So understanding that difference too. So whether you remove or add, understanding that first off, removing a small thing, it might be a bright green, like, you know, like the Klarna, Afterpay, all those yeah. things. We've moved those around or sometimes removed those and nothing got hit. But the thing is, all we did was remove that and like 40% conversion rate improvement on a PDP, because really? It's that bright color that's distracting them from everything else. So just because it's physically like small doesn't mean that it's not a big test.
Right.
So that's number one. And number two, when we start with new clients, we find there's a lot of bullshit on the site.
Yeah.
Mm. Just remove it. Like
yeah.
usually what, like one of our first tests that we run on homepages undoubtedly is removing elements. That's yeah. like remove elements. Like we have a nomenclature that we use like internally. So like homepage, remove elements is pretty much the first test for every single person. So it's like we test removing different options. So like it'll be like an ABCD test. Like we think this one could definitely go, this and this could go, this and this could go, and maybe move this guy up. And we can structure that as one test to be pretty bold and give yourself, obviously, if they have enough traffic, like
right.
now, like we've got a higher threshold of clients we work with, but you know, making sure that we can. So removing things typically is like our first go-to, because we can like, I mean, you can code it in 2 minutes.
Yeah. Yeah.
Like you can, on Google Optimize, you can right click remove.
Yeah.
So like you can remove elements real fast.
Yeah.
So like, I mean, I can sign a client, you know, 2 minutes later do that. So that's kind of like some
easy
quick
wins
we get.
Yeah.
yeah. So, and the other thing too, shout out Nick again. He told me that I was always talking about it wrong, which is like, we'll find some, like even in the sales process, I'd be like to my agency owners out there, we'll find some quick wins. We'll get some, you know, big early victories. Like, it's yeah. like, no, they're actually compounding data points.
Yeah.
Meaning if I improve your homepage conversion rate 7%, which is only globally going to be like 1%, you yeah. know, something like that. But then we improve the next test like another 4%. You now have a, you know, compounding improvement effect. And then now your emails, if they're going to the homepage and something else, now we do another test like 3 months later that does a 20% increase on the homepage. From where you first were, assuming your conversion rate stayed the same, you're looking at like a 50% increase, not a 4 plus like 11 plus
right.
or 7 plus 11 yeah. plus, you know, 20. It's exponential. So okay. the compounding data effect's crucial.
Do you look at like new and returning cohorts is different?
Where absolutely.
Because going back to your point of like changing the website, I got a really amazing audit done. Shout out audit, a bunch of amazing
Sean,
Canadians.
You're the man. Sean
is amazing.
Taylor, yeah, they're our them. Biggest partners,
amazing
honestly.
Amazing people, amazing humans.
By the way, if you look at audit, you'll see that it's backed by splittesting.com's database.
Amazing. We only hang with the homies. And they did this amazing audit, and we actually overhauled a site. This is when I was at my agency, and it was beautiful and everything worked out well, but we saw a little bit of actual degradation in the conversion rate. And my thesis was that, I mean, when we looked at the actual data, it was almost all coming from returning customers. And because mm-hmm. you get a vibe and you get like, oh, and you move stuff around, mm-hmm. it's kind of like, you know, you change your own grocery store layout or something that you're really accustomed to, and people, and not that it wasn't a great thing. It was just like people can get really used to inefficiencies mm-hmm. and we removed those inefficiencies. And
yeah.
it took a little bit, it ended up normalizing and netted out, excuse me, in the positive, but it was just interesting to me because everything made sense and like it all worked out. And the new customer conversion rate was fantastic, but we did take a little bit of hit in terms of those incumbent cohorts. How do you deal with that, or how do you think about that? Or like, because I'm with you on that, where there's just overhauling a website is just, I'd rather just play with landers all day and just put paid traffic that way versus overhauling the website. Because in retrospect, I think that's probably what we should have done, is just kind of ease people into a new aesthetic versus like, oh, hey, look at this beautiful new site.
Whole thing. Yeah. So I've got a fat piece of advice for everyone at home. So there's four main ones. So when you go to Google Analytics, you have those filters or those two little boxes that are at the top. You can post-production, you can take my fingers and you can filter by almost anything. You can make custom filters, but just go mobile and desktop. So when we're choosing a test as a winner, your mobile code base and your desktop code base are literally different websites. Like, they're not even the same. Like, Shopify has two different code bases for your mobile and desktop website. So a test can win on mobile and lose on desktop.
That's interesting.
So that's number one. So if you're a CRO firm or anyone else, like if you guys are split testing internal, whatever it is, if you just go based on total, you just failed.
Interesting.
Because like I said, you can have different changes. So think of four, and then so other than mobile and desktop, there's also new versus returning. And that's also pre-done filters. You just hit the drop down and, you know, and it hits, you know, new and returning. So those are four things that you need to look at. So I always make custom filters of desktop new, mobile new, desktop returning, and desktop new.
Yeah.
So though, I don't know if I messed mobile that up, new, but you guys get what I'm saying. So it's like, you know, you have four custom filters that now that's how we really judge. Mm-hmm. So everyone at the bare minimum, look at mobile and desktop, because we found a lot where like, we're marketers, we're working on the computer. So not a lot of people have this. So I actually like pay for my team members. We have a little clip that you put your phone right next to your computer, which highly recommend. You have your phone here, should I put it on silent so you can work. But like when you're looking at your website, pull it up right here and look at your phone. Because people don't do that enough. Mobile is 90%. So this means 90%. This means 10%.
Yeah.
So going back on the mobile and desktop, what's super crucial is, you know, looking at each of those cohorts. So if it's winning on, let's say like returning users tanks, but new users, it's great. That's called personalization.
Tracking.
So yeah, so personalization means you're feeding different experiences to different people based on what is on the website. So new versus returning is a behavior. Mobile versus desktop is a behavior. There's also location-based, right? Like if you go to neilpatel.com, like, you know, the SEO legend, it's my favorite. It says, I'm looking for a business in Brooklyn, New York to improve. Yeah. Like, is it yours? So it's like personalization, obviously, to like location. So you can feed in Google Optimize and you press it permanent. So literally, if you don't do this already, Ash, go back to all your historical tests and filter every single result for new versus returning. Mm-hmm. And you may be like, damn, overall it was losing, but it crushed it for new ones. You can go on Google Optimize, set up an experiment for personalization and press like go and permanently. And now for the rest of eternity on your website, only new users see that experience versus old. So it takes no code, no anything. Mm-hmm. You can personalize after that. So there's mobile, desktop, new, returning, and that's like, I don't know, 80, 90% of like the actual experimentation that we do, the results.
So you're probably deploying like, even if it's just like, all right, mobile is crushing for new, you'll probably just deploy that and can the rest. See, I think that's where people kind of mess up. Yeah. And it's like, because we redid our entire homepage, right?
Yeah.
And what we saw was the same thing that you said.
Right.
Returning was a lower conversion rate, but new customers were higher.
Yeah.
I think we made that executive decision because overall, it was more of a, it just depicted our brand a little bit better than what it was before, which was like just collection and buy boxes and stuff. But our customers were used to that. Right. Mm-hmm. So that's probably why it decreased a little bit. But I think over time, right, customers get used to it and they're like, okay, I can find things again. But to your point, it's like, what if we just made that entire experience a little bit more personalized to new visitors and then not have to worry about reteaching customers where they find their favorite products, right?
Yeah.
That's a great point.
So on the homepage, the ones that we find are the best is, like I said, above the fold. So to contextually now, like, you know, the listeners can like kind of follow along on the logic, the hero image, like, you know, yeah. above the fold, and the headline are two of the biggest that are ripe for personalization.
Yeah,
so right. let's say, like, for gummies, it's like the best collagen in the world, right? So it's like that's for new visitors, right? Because yeah. they're now meeting the best collagen in the world.
Exactly.
But what about the new returning, like returning users? Like ready to re-up on your, yeah. you know, thing. Like so a, if people have visited a certain,
yeah.
well, no, not the deal. This is a headline where you're just changing the messaging to returning users, which is like, you know, improving hair loss, right? Like now you can drive the value proposition instead of like introducing them to a brand because right. they already know you. They've been
right.
there before.
Right, right, right.
So it's like not necessarily a sale or a discount. You can go that route. Like right. I've done that before where right. like 20% returning discount, but like the thing is you don't know if they purchased or not. You can
true,
target it that way,
true.
But you can change your messaging just a little bit of like,
makes
you know,
sense.
Meet your new, you know, plug makes for health
yeah.
versus like, you know, continue improving your health.
Right.
So those are two very different headlines, very different headlines fundamentally.
Right.
So that you can have for new versus returning.
Or even, I guess you're right though, you'd have to have some sort of tracking in terms of purchase, but even being able to, and I get what you're saying because it does start to get into the offer, but a lot of people never subscribe on the first purchase, right?
Mm-hmm.
But at the same time, like almost everybody's subscription is like the best economics purchase, like all things being equal, like you would love people to hit the subscribe and save versus
mm-hmm.
actually just one-off purchase. And so there's some things you can get into there. That's so fascinating. I never thought of it that way.
So would you say that you would be pushing these changes live just through like Google Optimize, or is this something that you can also, like how do people do this? Like, is mm-hmm. it only through that? Is there apps that you can
no.
do that?
So there's,
can you
there's
build
a lot
it natively
of-
too?
Yes, you can build native, like I'm like, so you can build anything native,
yeah.
right? Like, especially that, I mean, think like 90% of our clients are on Shopify.
Right.
You can build anything native. That's like, you know, there's, if your developer ever says no, it means you need a better developer.
That's what the money's for.
That's what the money's for. Holy Lord. So my team's been blowing my mind lately. I'm like, whoa, you were able to do that? That's crazy.
Yeah.
So, you can make it custom. Google Optimize has a really like convenient setting, which is how you go into the editor and however you changed it.
Right.
You can just go in and instead of like, you know how there's like the A-B test, multivariate test,
personalization.
It's yeah. right there.
Yeah.
So you hit that personalization, you do the test experiment and you just click go. And that's it. So that's the easiest way to do it. Like the least amount of code, the easiest way. It's
yeah.
free.
Yeah.
That's why I recommend Google Optimize for it. So that's there's right. like other personalization. Like if you Google personalization, like that's the future of CRO
yeah.
is how personalized can you make your website to every single different user? The message for people who are coming through Google Ads, if you got down to it, like some of our biggest clients, they have like, you know, I don't know, like collagen dash one, collagen dash two, collagen dash five, six, seven, eight, nine.
Yeah.
And they all are identical except for like
the headline.
The headline.
Yeah.
Exactly. So it's like to yeah. match that. So getting into crazy personalization is how you ultimately
yeah.
scale. Like, yeah, ads are great, but like each of these personalized like channels, like email and SMS, you know, like scaling ads, it has an ancillary benefit by getting more people in, but you need to make sure it's personalized. So
yeah.
Google Optimize is the easiest way. But if you Google personalization, you'll see like Rebuy. Rebuy is like a really cool Shopify app. Do you guys use it?
We just started looking into it, yeah.
Cool. So
yeah.
would recommend
yeah.
but only for people that have like many SKUs.
Right.
Because like it's really good at personalization and like AI learning of
that's
like-
That's the Amazon kind of mimic, right?
Exactly.
Because Amazon, like mm-hmm. everybody's like Facebook newsfeed equivalent of Amazon, like everybody's, it's a bazillion different homepages. Like everybody, it's that Amazon homepage is essentially unique to you. And so this 100%. Is the Shopify thing.
So this is a Shopify
again?
Plugin. It's called Rebuy. Rebuy. Shout out if you want to reach
good.
Out to us for a good
sponsor
partnership.
The pod, that's
yeah,
good.
We do. Sponsor the podcast. Yeah, it's really good. But the only thing that I do use it for is recommended purchases. That's what I found that Rebuy has nailed it. So that's a different area of personalization
yeah.
than the actual stuff. Like personalization, if you Google it, like how do I personalize my, you know, e-com store? It's like, oh, recommended purchases, or you may also like. That's
right.
what Rebuy is really good for. You put it in and their AI ultimately like figures out what is actually the best. So
right.
for you guys, I do think Rebuy on the bottom of your PDPs
right.
would probably be solid.
Right. Right.
Makes just sense. A guess. Just like, not financial advice. Yeah.
No, 100%. No, it makes sense because I think we're doing it in a way where we're doing that research of like, okay, what are some similar, or even through Triple Whale, it tells us frequently bought together, right? So it's exactly. Like on these products, like, all right, you may also want this, this, and this, right? Which is similar to the Amazon, you know, add mm-hmm. all to cart. So I think that might be good because then at least there's some type of intelligence that's like looking at all the factors and then showing mm-hmm. that dynamically. Absolutely. I think Shopify had that, right? I don't know if it's any good, to be honest.
I only knew of the plugin.
Yeah. There's dynamic product recommendations. I don't know if like
there it are, even works. Well, you do need to be on Shopify Plus for that. So that's like a minimum $2,000 to $4,000 per month, which not everyone can. Yeah. I'll bellyache of the GA4 problem too. Yeah.
Don't get me started on GA4. Yeah. I can't believe Google's just going to blow up their UA. It's nuts. There's like no roadmap. Yeah. There's no succession plan. It's just like, oh, F you guys, you got to use this horrible, horrible thing called GA4.
It's horrendous.
Horrendous. We're talking about Google Analytics 4 for anybody. And when we say UA, it's Universal Analytics, which is like mm-hmm. the dummies version of it. You can just put it in and it absolutely works versus Google Analytics 4. You actually have to understand data pipelining. You have to put a nice data pipeline together. It is atrocious. Right. Like you have to be really high. Or from my experience, it's been like really bad to implement.
It's
you have to be really high level.
Fucking worst. Yeah. It's horrible. Google, we love you and we also hate you. Yeah, thanks a lot for nothing. Yeah. No, it's so, yeah. So luckily, Google Optimize now integrates with GA4. I actually have like a little focus group of a couple of fellow nerds who are like trying to figure it out. I believe I cracked the code.
Oh, look at this. Reach out to my man if you need that
GA4. Shameless plug, which is not available to the public yet, but we made a software that goes straight into the Google Analytics 4 API, renames everything, and talks and looks. We're considering, like I'm talking to a couple of e-com owners, like what they want. Theoretically, my goal is to make a Universal Analytics 4 clone.
Amazing.
So that's an upcoming thing. So like just sticking on the CRO side, like, you know, I've got a couple SaaS products coming out that like literally will automate a lot of split testing, like full machine learning. I wrote a multi-arm bandit that like gets to statistical significance faster other than just 1, 2, 3, 4, 1, 2, 3, 4, because you can start autopilot pushing traffic to the better performing ones and prove it faster. So I've got a couple innovations coming up that you guys will be hearing about.
Look at this. One door closes, another opens.
I love that.
A couple more questions. One, when you're talking conversion rate, do you like to look at how many people actually come to the site, or are you going straight from PDP to purchase? Because I know people sometimes have a content play, and I always recommend, depending on the context, and I want to answer for you, but just as my viewpoint was, when people are coming to read content, I consider that like them coming to my library, versus when people get into like a slash product or something, I consider that them actually kind of quote unquote coming into my shop. And I actually like to measure that, because if not, if you have a huge content database, like, and you're getting a ton of content traffic, you might have like a 0.5 conversion rate, and it, like people aren't coming there to shop. And so it's like it kind of can pervert that conversion rate. How do you think of that?
I want you to answer that first.
Yeah. How do you think of that? Because you guys do have pretty strong content too.
I think the biggest thing is we'll never, like exactly what you said, right? It's I'm sending you there just for the purpose of education.
Yeah.
Right. So for example, if I think we send out weekly recipes.
Right.
It's a way to kind of cross sell. So like if you purchased a fruity cereal and we're showing you a recipe of cocoa cereal waffles, right? It's like, okay, you can still use your fruity cereal collagen for that, but then like it kind of shows you there's other flavors that you can utilize it for. But it's tough because there's no call to action on the recipe page, right? I want you to be there to either continue looking at other recipes. So like the CTA is go to the next one, not go to the product, right?
May want to test that, homie.
Well, and to be fair though, to just push back is like you might already have the product.
Yeah.
So you've already bought.
It's true. It is true.
Learning how to use it and consume it. And so
a lot of those, like for example, a lot of the texts and emails that go out because of that, a lot of the conversions that happen after are view through, not click through.
Mm-hmm.
Right.
Zing.
Tricky man. Yeah. It's like, so I do agree with you. So I have like three or four clients that just smash SEO.
Yeah.
And they're looking at the blogs and they're like, how do we convert to customers? And in Google Analytics, there's pathways that you can see entrance pages and exit pages. Yep. So are they coming from like the main homepage, clicking to a blog and then just bouncing?
Yeah.
Are they first on a blog, then go to the homepage, product page and then drop? Yeah. So like, you know, you kind of figure out where the leaky hole is in the bucket.
Yep.
So with the content, there's definitely different KPIs. Like for SEO, I mean, it sounds crazy, but like I'm actually trying to help the SEO team further as like a CRO agency. Like, let's get your time on page higher. Like, let's get in exactly all those metrics that you get to improve and get better usable content. Yeah. There was a client today where we looked at their heat map and they did a little summary at the top. In this article, you'll learn this, this, and this. And they didn't have hyperlinks going down.
Yeah.
So we saw on the heat map that it was, and I was like, let's test this. And boom, oh my God, the time on site like went through the roof. It was like a 60% increase in time on site, like of the page. And the click-through rate to other pages was like a bumped 30%. So you're 100% right that there's different like intentions. And also go back to empathy mapping. Yeah. That's the other thing too, of like understanding where they are in their journey with you. That's what it ultimately comes back to as a North Star.
Makes sense.
Powerful anchor links. Yeah, that makes a ton of sense. Dang, I just lost my train of thought.
I had a really big question, I think, right? The biggest thing that I think we were talking about this before we started, right, is conversion rate versus like AOV, right? Right now, I think, you know, towards the beginning of the year, it's like, all right, how do I improve my conversion rate? I just want to acquire customers at the lowest cost right now, right? Mm-hmm. Which is, I think we nailed that. And I think we took out all the friction of buying. It's like, all right, you come to the website, you go through this landing page, you understand what the product is. All right, you can either buy one bottle or two, and that's it, right? To some people's point, it's like remove the two and just go all in on the one, and your conversion rate will probably skyrocket. But my CAC is still going to be $30-$40. I'll probably move a little bit more volume, but like, how do I think the main question here is, how do I balance between conversion rate but then AOV as well, right? So like, my CAC is like, I can right now at like 20k a day, my CAC is at 50, right? My AOV is at 60. I can't get anything lower as I scale, right? So the only thing I can do, like, I can make better creatives. I don't think it's gonna move the needle as much as moving the needle on CRO, right? So either I get people to buy more, or just, I think that's my thing is, I need to get people to buy more, right? So how do I do that without impacting conversion rate?
Totally. Yeah. So comes down to that original part of ask your customers what they want and just give it to them. Like, what is their goal? Is their goal to change their lifestyle? If it is, you need three products. You need three different products in a bundle together to change your actual lifestyle or health or hair or anything like that. So comes back to that offer that you give. Dig in more to the offer. Find offers that are more money, more value. Like, you get what you pay for, and you can sell what they're paying for too. So that's my answer number one. Answer number two, the default of like where you see, you know, of like which bundle you see first, right? Of like what they click on. That's another way that, like, easy way, it doesn't really hurt conversion rate. Like, make sure your default is like, if you have one, three, and five, if you have one, three, and five in your buy boxes, make sure three or five is usually, I mean, it's something we test, but make sure three or five is like your default that people go to first. Yeah.
And it doesn't hurt conversion rate. Or you've seen it not hurt conversion rate.
No, it doesn't hurt conversion rate and boosts AOV a bit. So again, not financial advice. Go test.
Try it.
That's another one. And then obviously post-purchase upsells.
Yep.
So that's another thing that people do. So pre-purchase upsells is something also that actually can hurt conversion rates.
Yeah.
If you continue selling.
So
So in the cart itself, if you're selling, it doesn't mean don't do pre-purchase upsells.
Right.
But post-purchase upsells, meaning like, to those who don't know at home, one-click upsell, Ezra Firestone, you have the best mastermind. Yeah. We love you.
So OG in the game.
Oh, Ezra's the man. You know, Zipify one-click upsell. So like, after they purchase, it's like, would you like to buy another?
Yeah.
So that offer right there, you can go crazy with those.
Yeah.
I have a trick that I use for supplement brands, which works best for consumables, but here's a little dirty secret. What does your upsell look like after people buy? I know you probably have like a couple of conditionals, but overall, what's your most popular upsell?
So that we have two, right? So for one of our main funnels, which is our burn supplement, we get another one for X amount off, right? Mm-hmm. That has like a 16% take rate. Mm-hmm. I tried a new one for our collagen one. So on the landing page, I'm testing showing 4 flavors. And then in the post-purchase, I'm showing 4 new flavors of like, hey, these are limited edition flavors. You can only get it here. That had a 20% take rate.
That's cool.
Crazy. On one bottle?
On one bottle, yes.
Cool. Yeah. You want to hear something crazy? Yeah. Are you ready?
Yeah.
Hold your pants.
Drum rolls, please.
Upsell 8 bottles.
Jesus.
If anybody does, it's your community. I've seen some of those pictures.
Yeah, so yeah, it's crazy. So like, so much if you're, yeah, it's insane, right? So it's like, here's the
I
thing.
I probably won't see these people for another year though.
That's the one.
Would you rather the money now though, or right? Now or
that's
never?
That's a fair point. That's a fair point for sure.
So, and there's a discount, but you're getting it now and you're getting guaranteed sales. So the thing is, we have it conditional based on like, if it's a first time buyer, second time buyer, again, personalization.
Yeah.
Right. I upsell way more bottles than they need. So for my supplement brands, my smallest upsell is 5 bottles.
All right.
And the take rate is around like 9 or 10%, which is not much less than yours, but mine's worth damn a lot more. And also when you push more units together, your COGS go down, cost of goods go down,
for sure.
Which is again, more margin. So
less
it's like
picking and all these things.
Exactly. Yeah. So the post purchases, be an animal. Like some people go really aggressive on email marketing. You opt into their like pop-up.
Yeah.
They literally send you 4 emails a day for the next 3 days.
Yeah.
You either get hella unsubscribes or hella sales. You get both.
Right.
So it's like a big burn strategy. Like, I mean, you already got the sale. Why not upsell like 6 or 8, you know? Because if people really like the product, they're like, I'm going to use this anyways. Like I can just put it in my house. Now I get a 40% discount. And with that many units, you can give a 40% discount and your unit economics are killer.
Yeah. Makes sense.
That's amazing.
Wow.
I will caution people though about hitting email too hard. I had a agency that took over when I left and they were sending like 78 million emails a month. And like the first month and a half, like the numbers looked amazing. But the growth in like it was a negative net growth in his list subscriber and like people are getting pissed off and like you can't email something where you need to make sure that it's tactful. Like it can't just be a money grab, and SMS is even worse or more sensitive where it's just such an intimate medium. So definitely, again, whatever the goal is, like if it is a money grab, you know, smash email, do your thing. But email should be a tactful play, in my opinion. And you need to make sure that you're generating value for the user, not just using them as a bank account. One last question and we'll wrap up.
Yep.
Shipping. You guys ever mess around with shipping? How like important is free shipping, no shipping? Because you guys did some really interesting stuff with shipping, right?
That we're about to.
We're about to. Okay.
Yeah.
Well, so you tell me what your plan is and I'll tell you if I...
So the plan, right? Customers, if you're listening, sorry. So we want to... So we want to... So right now we offer free shipping, right? Right now what we
do... No threshold.
There's technically no threshold, but when you do add to cart, it does say you've unlocked it at like $25.
Got it.
Just so that it's like, oh, I've earned this, right? Customers, you're going to get it regardless. So now what we want to do is... We want to get these people who are buying just a single bottle to get one more thing. So we're thinking of raising that threshold to actually put it at 50 and then charging flat fee of $4 or $5, right? And then if that first threshold is 50 and then the next threshold for a free gift is 75 and then a 125 and then 175, right? So it's like one more product just to get to the next tier. It's not like 2 or 3, right? It's like just add one more thing, right? So we're thinking of using free shipping as that initial like gamification, like, oh, I just unlocked this. Well, wait, $25 more, I can get a shaker cup. $25 more, I can get this, right? So that's the test we want to do. Just have to get around to it.
Truthfully, that sounds like several tests in one. I would stick to, you know, like if you want to gamify it, that's like a whole plan, right? Like you would need a CRO rollout to confirm.
It's all there. It's basically all there.
Yeah. So here's a dirty trick. Everyone has done a countdown timer before in e-commerce, right?
Right.
Is it really a countdown timer? No. Sorry, customers of Avi. It's not a real countdown timer. You can still buy after 10 minutes or whatever.
Yeah.
There's only 3 units left. Buy now before they're out of stock.
God, that's kind
of cool. So, you know, those have gotten you, especially on the shoes. So no, like,
the shoes might be real, though, to be fair.
yeah, it's true. Right?
Well, you never know. That's why you put it there. Okay. So, so what we've done before is keep your full free shipping, but say free shipping at 50 at 60, 75, and 100, but it's always free shipping.
Interesting.
So people think it, and then they get to the cart, and they're like, wait, hold on. I thought it was $50 unlocked. It's 30? Click. Boom.
Choose.
Yeah. Sense.
So this is...
So it's like an intentional typo or error that's in the customer's favor.
Right.
This is really interesting. So I don't know if you guys as logistics can do this, but somebody was actually doing something similar where basically it was like a two-day shipping. And you would get like the two-day shipping for free, but like not for free. Like everybody was pretty much like their logistics were capable of two-day shipping. Mm-hmm. But you, I don't remember if you would pay a little more or you would hit a threshold and then you get the two-day shipping so you'd get it faster or what have you. But it was in the same vein
expedited delivery.
That's what it was. Yeah, in the same vein where it's like, oh, I get my stuff faster because I bought more. So anyways, I'm kind of in the weeds there, but that's that's incredible.
I'm gonna try that immediately.
Now. Yeah, Ash has like totally that. DM'd me a bunch of times like, hey man, I'm gonna implement this right now and get back to you now. And he never gets back to me.
I don't know, some of these tests
I'm like, man, you're reciting some CRO hacks, buddy.
Yeah, for this one I'm gonna have to definitely test, because I was thinking about it last night. I was talking to Ron about it and I was like, all right, well, we're gonna have to, you know, change the shipping, and like you said, it's a lot of steps, so makes sense to just up the tier and just that's it.
One other thing on this too, in the announcement bar at the top, there's this thing called, I think it's called AOV countdown, or like AOV countdown time or something like that. And it says free shipping at like $75, and they add $25 to cart and it says $50 more to free shipping. Like it's a dynamic Shopify app. Like it's a plugin.
We had something similar for, I used to work for my agency. We had a beard care client and we had a bundle builder page because one of the things that he was getting crushed with was AOV. Like his mode AOV was like
Anthony Mink.
No, never mind.
Took a swing.
But it was this bundle builder where it was essentially like this little sticky sidebar and you had this collection of products and like, oh, buy this, that, and that. And we controlled those products because you would make a collection to make sure that they were high margin because you didn't want people to buy like, you know, three low margin products and then all of a sudden you get 50% off kind of thing. And so you have to make sure the economics netted out. But it worked out really well. It wasn't great for new customers, which would make sense. Mm-hmm. But for our returning customers, we really smashed that and it crushed in terms of boosting the AOV in terms of our new customer or returning customers to get them to spend more money because you already like the product. And then we would have like a brush and then these things that kind of like built well. And then you get like 30% off and we get this higher AOV. So the acquisition cost was there. So, all right. One last creepy question and then we'll wrap up. So this is actually, I didn't do my homework. I've been traveling. I'm sorry, folks. And Dylan actually saved me. But and this is why he's going to have a better answer probably than me and Ash. But the question is it more efficacious to dry off in the shower or out of the shower? I'm going to go first, so I'll give you some time to answer. And you already have the answer, so we'll have you wrap up because you'll probably have the best answer. But my vote is out of the shower. Because sometimes I'm a little loosey-goosey with the towel and it's the bane of my existence when like the little corner hits a puddle and then I like get like some of the towel wet. So I'm an out of the shower guy.
Very similar. Yeah, out of the shower. But also you have the bath mat outside in it. Kind of.
Exactly.
Yeah. Right. So I'll quick pat and then hop out.
Yeah.
Yeah. Well, that's my...
Oh, so you're quick pat in the shower.
Yeah. No, I have my towel like hanging, so I could just grab it, quick pat, and then I'm out. Not fully.
So you're an in the shower guy.
Well, yeah, I guess we have to define drying off then, right? Yeah.
How long?
I think I am. Because
I'm not technically dry when I get out.
I'm an in the shower patter, out of the shower. The other thing too.
In shower patter, out shower dryer.
Well, the other thing I just realized too is the shower configuration matters too. Like if it's a bathtub shower configuration, it's a totally different strategy than if it's a stand-up shower for me.
Yeah, it's true.
That's why you can't take CRO financial advice.
Running multivariate testing on shower testing.
Well, here's the thing.
So what's the right answer here?
The reason I did
the
this
right
is
answer.
In college, we had a public speaking class and they said you can debate any topic, more ridiculous the better. And this was our debate. So in the structured debate, we won for in the shower. Because
I'm 0% in on that.
Well, here's the thing. You're in Texas. We're in New York. When it's winter, you're going to be freezing when you get out of the shower. So you're not going to want that. That's number one. Number two, mm-hmm. you save yourself water on the floor where you can slip and potentially die.
But that's poor people stuff. We got bath mats. We're yeah. rich
whoa,
folks.
Come on, whoa, come whoa. On. You're going to say that no water gets beyond the bath mat, or is your whole bathroom a bath
but
mat?
But it's tile. Right? And actually,
and what's tile on water?
To be fair, I lived in Indiana and our house had a bathroom in the carpet, which
carpet in the bathroom?
How ridiculous is that?
That's
so okay. Oh, I will give you the temperature control. You definitely get cold and you slap that, you grab the towel and you close the curtain.
Are you telling me your bathroom doesn't steam up completely?
It does.
Well, it depends sometimes too if you have a sketchy water heater and stuff, but the temperature.
You said rich people shit. I don't have a sketchy heater.
Exactly. The temperature control is a good vector. I didn't think of that.
Well, here's one downside of in the shower.
What about the danger of the, do you do the foot up on the side or something like that? Because what if you're in a stand-up
the
shower?
The hard to reach areas.
The towel dip is like the bane of my existence. I can't do it because like you.
I don't want it to touch. Yeah, I don't want it to touch.
You render like a corner of the towel useless because it's wet now. Like you can't dry off with a wet towel. So how do you get around that problem?
Well, that is the
what if you
downside.
Accidentally drop the towel?
Oh, done, right? I drop it outside. I don't know.
But if you're outside, you bend over and like there's like water coming out. And now like everything's wet.
No, but it's on the floor.
And then you can slip and die.
I don't know. I think
the safety risk.
Outside.
Yeah. I'm on team inside.
You're inside?
I'm team inside.
I mean, I've been doing this for 20 years. I can't change now, guys. So team outside. I get the points. They're all valid. Team outside.
Amazing. All right, tweet at us. Are you team inside or team outside shower? Dylan, this was such a blast, dude. Thank you so Love much this. For coming on. Splittesting.com. Tell people how they can get more involved with you. Where can they follow you? This time is yours, my friend.
Splittesting.com. That's long the short of it. It's what we do. Find me on Twitter. DM me. Ask me questions. I'm genuinely here to support. There's so many answers that I have now that I didn't have when I was either starting or in the middle of my journey. If it's about CRO, I've also ran, you know, dozens of millions in ads and all of that. So if you guys just have e-com questions, come to me. DMs are open. It is me. I am there to help. So, you know, if you guys are a brand doing over, I don't know, you know, a couple million a year, definitely talk. We've got a money back guarantee. It'll blow your minds. But other than that, I'm here to help, here to support. Follow along at splittesting.com or splittesting.com without the dot on Twitter. And appreciate it, gentlemen.
Tell us about the vitamin shop. Tell us about the mentor pass. You know what to do, Ash.
Somebody actually tweeted me today. I'm very grateful. Picture
with
of
the vitamin shop.
Vitamin shop.
Well, you guys were just out. Was it in Jersey?
Yeah, we just did a little pop-up in Jersey just to get some taste testing.
The table wrap looked good. The whole setup's clean.
I saw it pops.
It slaps for sure.
But yeah, if you're ever by a vitamin shop, check it out. Avi, send me a picture on Twitter. I'm mentor pass right now. And just follow me on Twitter at @AshvimOlani.
You've been dropping some thread heat.
Yeah,
it's
recently.
I feel a little jelly. Been putting some numbers down. gonna step it up.
Ride the momentum.
Amazing. You're really settling into your guru status here.
Guru, just baby. Just showing what's working for us and amazing. Anybody.
I wish I could be a guru like Ash.
We got to wrap this up.
Amazing. All right, folks. We are headed to the New York Whale Roadshow. We are going to be in Toronto, London, and LA. It's going to be awesome sauce. We have a bunch of cool stuff coming out. So if you want to follow more, do @TripleWhale on the Bird app and then trytriplewhale.com if you want to get more involved. We're actually, fingers crossed, going to triplewhale.com and then the app's moving to app. I know.
Let's go.
Remove the try.
Love
it's cleaner that way.
Thank God.
A little social network reference. So fingers crossed, we're going to be pushing that out. So really excited there. And then what else we got? Yeah, if you want to support my obnoxious sneaker habit, Kenny was telling me that Shaq actually donates all of his proceeds to like animal shelters, and I'm over here buying egregious actual sneakers. So if you want to support my obnoxious sneaker habit, go book a mentor pass. They're really fun. I love it. Kenny's built a really cool platform. It's been a really big blast.
Wait, show him your shoes. Like, lift your leg.
I don't know if you can see these.
Lift your leg, man.
I'm not as bendy, but. I'll post production. I got some heat on
right
today.
They're in like a top two, top three
proper heat. But we're going to the fancy meetup,
of course,
and then the fancy dinner afterwards. So you know,
that's it.
And the boss is in town. You got to look good. You got to look good.
Of course.
Awesome, folks. If you enjoyed this, share it, subscribe, smash that subscribe button, and. Dylan, thank you so much for not only setting this up. This is our first
in-person
one, which is a blast. I loved it in real life. Awesome, folks. That's it. and another one in the books. Thanks, Ash. Thanks, Dylan.